From bureaus worldwide, this is FSN.
Thank you, Simon. Welcome to Monday's Richie Allen Radio Show. Hope you had a fantastic weekend. I had a lovely weekend. In fact, I've had a lovely couple of days. Two terrific guests this Monday. It is the 21st of September 2020.
It's the BBG, not the BBC. You're listening to the Richie Allen Radio Show, live from Salford in Greater Manchester.
It's the Richie Allen Show, broadcasting live on richieallen.co.uk and multiple platforms around the world. And now, here's your host, Richie Allen.
Now, Dr. Vernon Coleman joins us this hour around about 5:30, an old man in a chair. The third such visit from Vernon. We're going to do this every Monday for the foreseeable future. He'll be with me, vernoncoleman.com. Lots to talk about, obviously, with Vernon, if you're listening to the news there. And later on in the programme, David Vance, the conservative writer and broadcaster, will return to this programme as well, a little bit later on in the second there. Lots to talk about. He was recently deleted by Twitter. Well, we'll get into it a bit later on. Interesting times. As usual, if you'd like to tweet to me, it's very simple. It's at Richie Allen Show on Twitter, at Richie Allen Show, and I'll pick your tweets up as we go along. All right, lovely. I had a lovely couple of days, I don't mind telling you. Went to Ramsbottom yesterday with the Minister for Domestic Affairs, the Home Secretary, the Minister for the Domestic Environment. We went to Ramsbottom. We went with friends of ours. Now, the only time you should be messing with a sheep's anus is when you go to Ramsbottom. Sheep shagging is more of a Yorkshire thing, I believe. At least I've been told that anyway. We went with my mate John and his sons, Sean and Ryan. Lovely day in Ramsbottom, up near the Peel Monument. And there was good news at the end of the day as well, because John's partner, Maggie, has a cat called Silas, who had been missing for a few days. And she didn't come with us, waiting for him to come home. And he did come home. He swaggered in late yesterday afternoon, as cats are prone to doing. Good stuff. Right, to today's big story then. And as I said earlier, I hope you've had a decent weekend this weekend yourself. You heard the news there. The UK could see 50,000 new coronavirus cases a day by mid-October, unless there's further action, according to the chief scientific advisor to the government, Patrick Vallance. He gave a, I don't know what you would call it today, he gave a presentation with the chief medical advisor, Professor Chris Whitty, telling us that the coronavirus cases are growing exponentially, and that if it isn't addressed, if it isn't stopped, it means that, well, catastrophe looms in the winter. All right. They said that yesterday a further 3,900 cases were reported and 18 deaths yesterday. All very strange. Do you want to hear a little bit of this? Just a brief listen. Here's, first of all, Chief Scientific Advisor Patrick Vallance. We'll hear Whitty in a moment. Here's Patrick Vallance.
We are in a situation where numbers are clearly increasing. They're increasing across all age groups. It's a little bit different in different areas in terms of geographies, and Chris will speak to that. And this increase in numbers is also translating into an increase in hospitalisation, which Chris will say more about. So there's no doubt we are in a situation where the numbers are increasing. What I'd like to do is just remind you how quickly this can move. So the next slide is not a prediction, but it is a way of thinking about how quickly this can change. So this is the UK reported cases per day against time. And you can see running along the bottom there, the number of cases over June, July and August, up to roughly 3,000 cases per day or so in September, middle of September. At the moment, we think that the epidemic is doubling roughly every 7 days. It could be a little bit longer, maybe a little bit shorter, but let's say roughly every 7 days. If, and that's quite a big if, but if that continues unabated and this grows doubling every 7 days, then what you see, of course, let's say there were 5,000 today, it would be 10,000 next week, 20,000 the week after, 40,000 the week after. And you can see that by mid-October, if that continued, you would end up with something like 50,000 cases in the middle of October per day. 50,000 cases per day would be expected to lead a month later, so the middle of November, say, to 200 plus deaths per day.
I won't say too much about this because Dr. Vernon Coleman will be joining me soon enough and he'll have plenty to say on it, I would imagine. Here's Chief Medical Advisor Chris Whitty.
We also know that some of the things we've had to do are going to cause significant problems in the economy, big social impacts, impacts on mental health, and therefore ministers making decisions and all of society have to walk this very difficult balance. If we do too little, this virus will go out of control and we will get significant numbers of increased direct and indirect deaths. But if we go too far the other way, then we can cause damage to the economy, which can feed through to unemployment, to poverty, to deprivation, all of which have long-term health effects. So we need always to keep these two sides in mind. We have to break unnecessary links between households because that is the way in which this virus is transmitted. And this means reducing social contacts, whether they are at work. And this is where we have enormous gratitude to all the businesses, for example, who worked so hard to make their environments COVID secure to reduce the risk, and also in social environments. And we have to try and do this in the least damaging way. But we all know we cannot do this without some significant downsides. And this is a balance of risk between if we don't do enough, the virus will take off. And we at the moment, that is the path that we are clearly on. And if we do not change course, then we're going to find ourselves in a very difficult problem, as Patrick has laid out.
Very difficult, a difficult problem even. They droned on for 15 to 20 minutes about how dangerous everything is. They said people should not be allowed to decide for themselves that they'll take their chances with the virus. They wanted to reiterate that because it impacts everyone else. You can't, as an individual, decide, well, no, I will go about my daily business, and if I get the virus, well, so be it. I'm young, I'm dumb, and I'm full of piss and vinegar. I will take my chances with the virus. You can't do that, they said. Okay. Vaccines, they came to. You'll hear Chris Whitty, Chief Medical Advisor, first, very briefly. Then you will hear Valance on vaccines.
And if we don't do enough, the virus will take off. And we, at the moment, that is the path that we are clearly on. And if we do not change course, then we're going to find ourselves in a very difficult problem, as Patrick has laid out. The final thing we can do is the science. Is investing in drugs, vaccines, diagnostics, and Patrick is going to take us through as the final section where we've got to with the most exciting of these, which is vaccines.
The most exciting of these slides. They were showing you slides, you see. Very exciting now, vaccines.
Come on. Thank you very much. As Chris has said, we will be living with this virus. This is now circulating amongst the population worldwide. It will continue to do so. We will be learning how to live with it. One important part of that is vaccines. I'm pleased to say that there is good progress that's been made. Many vaccines now have shown they generate an immune response of a type that ought to be protective. And several vaccines are in very late stage clinical testing, aiming to show that they are both effective and safe. The UK, through the Vaccines Task Force, has got access to a number of these, as illustrated on this slide, with a range of different vaccine technologies from a number of different companies. The UK, therefore, has put itself in a good position in terms of vaccine supply and the possibility that one of these will work. We don't yet know that they will work, but there is increasing evidence that it's pointed in the right direction, and it's possible that some vaccine could be available before the end of the year in small amounts.
Before the end of the year in small amounts, there is a possibility, he said.
For certain groups, much more likely that we'll see vaccines becoming available over the first half of next year. Again, not certain, but pointed in the right direction, which then, of course, gives the possibility of a different approach to this virus. But in the meantime, we've got to get on control of this in the way...
Yeah, we're going to make life as uncomfortable and unbearable as we possibly can for the next 6 months. So that you'll practically swig... If they had bottles of vaccines, you'll swig it. You'll drink it like an Irishman on St. Paddy's Day. That's basically what he's saying there. And watching Chris Whitty and Patrick Vallance this morning, I was reminded very much of Statler and Waldorf. You remember them? Muppets. Absolute Muppets. And the most astonishing thing about this presentation this morning was that they broadcast it from Downing Street. Remember on Sunday View yesterday, I likened the Coronavirus Act to a coup. A coup for Billy Gates and his big pharma pals. Because now you've got guys like Vallance and Whitty dictating public policy. And I wonder, was there something in that today? I wonder, was there something very symbolic about the fact that Whitty and Vallance broadcast this garbage from Downing Street, and there wasn't a single government representative there. Not a single one. No sign of Johnson or Hancock or any other senior government front bench guy or gal. Symbolic, do you think? Was that sending a subliminal message to people? We're really running the show now, guys. You know what I mean? Staggering. And if that's not bad enough that these guys were in Downing Street broadcasting this stuff, journalists were neither present nor were they remotely present. They weren't invited to submit questions or even to ask questions at the conclusion of it. You don't believe that? Here's Adam Bolton from Sky a second after the puppet show ended, and they are Billy Gates' puppets. Here's Adam Bolton. No questions, please.
So that is the conclusion of what was a briefing, as we can see there, by Chris Whitty, the chief medical advisor to the government, and the chief scientific advisor, Sir Patrick Vallance. Now, we've been told not to anticipate any questions, and indeed there weren't any questions, just to give you the high points there.
And then he goes on to give you the high points there, the good news about the vaccines. Now, Bolton maybe at some time in his past would have been enraged by the fact that he wasn't allowed to pose a question to Whitty or Vallance, Statler and Waldorf, the Muppets. But he's fairly okay with it, you know, no problem. And the shame of no questions is really in the fact that the testing fiasco is slowly but surely getting dragged into the daylight. And by fiasco, I don't mean that people are not being tested. No, the fiasco is that the test is so flawed that last week in the House of Commons, Conservative MP Sir Desmond Swain asked Matt Hancock, his fellow Tory, the health secretary, he said, to what extent is there a possibility that it is the exponential increase in testing itself in identifying genuine new cases and the very significant possibility of false positives that is giving a distorted impression of the trajectory of the disease? And that was an outstanding question. And Matt Hancock, the health secretary, had a rather stupid answer. And of course, Swain doesn't get a comeback. You just get to ask a question you can't follow up. Later, on his website, Desmond Swain wrote this, and he is right. He writes, "The government website, when I last looked, stated the daily number of tests processed in the UK was 227,075. And the daily number of people testing positive is 3,105, which means that 1.37% of those tested had a positive result. Clearly, it doesn't take a mathematician to tell you that a relatively small percentage of false positives will have a significant impact on our estimate of how many people are infected. In fact, a report by the Office for National Statistics in June put false positives at 2.4%, which is even higher than the actual proportion of positives. We're threatened with more restrictions to our liberty, which will lay waste to even more of our employment opportunities. and will be more damaging to the health of anyone suffering from a medical condition other than COVID, all driven by policy reliant on what may be very misleading data. An astonishingly good Julia Hartley Brewer on talk radio got into this with Grant Shapps, who's the transport secretary. She got into the false positives with him on talk radio this morning, and this is hugely significant. Listen.
Has there been any conversation in Cabinet that you are aware of or you've been part of about the false positive rate? And the eminent statisticians and eminent epidemiologists are pointing out that the test we are using in the community, not the pillar one testing in hospitals, testing in the community, may well have a false positive rate of well, we're told it's below 1% by Matt Hancock last week, which means that 9 out of 10 of the positive cases of COVID we are finding in the community when we do random testing, when anyone just puts themselves forward, will be wrong. They will not be people who've got coronavirus. So we have got testing going up 3,899 cases, huge number of cases, but actually 9 out of 10 of those may well be false positives. Has there been any discussion about this serious concern in Cabinet?
And that is the most important question posed by a journalist to a politician in 2020.
Well, of course, the way that that testing is done is actually by the Office of National Statistics. People don't put themselves forward. The Office of National Statistics contact people randomly.
No, that's not what I'm talking about. No, I'm not talking about the data. There's the survey dating. I'm talking about people being told, go and get a test if you've, as Matt Hancock said in July, if you're in any doubt. People who, in local areas where there's been a high rate, people, councils leafleting saying, go and get a test. People being worried because their kids have been in a classroom with someone who's gone home with a cough. Those people, that testing, 9 out of 10 of those tests that are positive are very, very likely to be false positives. Has there been any discussion of this in Cabinet? And if not, why not?
Can you imagine the enormity of this? This is true. This is true. 9 out of 10 tests are giving false positives. And I've looked at this every which way but loose, and she's right. Everybody in the country needs to know this, but they won't, because apart from Julia Hartley Brewer on talk radio, nobody else has taken this on.
Well, because the medical experts will provide evidence on that. And there have been some very interesting things along the lines of what you're saying. For example, the NHS Test and Trace have carried out studies of people who are actually attending tests. So they've spoken to 24,000 people, 6,000 of whom didn't have any symptoms at all, but were going for tests. So if we're talking about how we're ending up in a situation where some of these tests are under a lot of pressure, it is important that you're only going for a test if you've been asked to do so by a medical professional in order to ensure we have enough tests available.
Has there been any discussion of the false positive rate in Cabinet? Has this been raised by anybody?
I haven't been involved in a false positive discussion, but I'm not the health secretary, and it's not been a generalised.
Wait a minute. Well, no. When we shut down our aviation industry, when we shut down our nighttime economy, when we shut down people's ability to have any contact with their families with the rule of six and with a possible lockdown, this is a matter of the entire Cabinet. We're not getting proper parliamentary scrutiny, which thankfully is going to start next week, so Graham Brady leading that. But is there any scrutiny in the Cabinet of someone saying, hold on a minute, some experts are pointing out, and there's no statistical evidence that these people are wrong, that 9 out of 10 of the positive cases we are identifying may actually be false, and we're basing an entire policy on false data?
Yeah, I don't think I don't think that's correct. I don't think we're basing our entire policy on false data, as you've suggested there. I'm slightly confused by your figures, but I'm going to go away and check them, because you also said that Matt Hancock said it's probably 1%.
This is my policy. This is a policy that's being made by people who don't understand the statistics and the science. I've got your phone number. I will send you a document to explain to you what this false positive paradox is.
There, haven't you? You've said to me.
Anyway, they rambled on for a few minutes, and Brewer got Shapps to commit to raising this in Cabinet meetings, or in a Cabinet meeting in the very near future. It's astonishing stuff, this. It was Desmond Swain who picked up on this last week, and this has been growing and growing in the independent media, of course. Brewer is the first one to take it on. And I know that the Oxford University professor, Carl Hennigan, tried to get into it on Sky News yesterday morning, up to a point, but didn't manage to get into it in any great depth. But 9 out of 10 of those who test positive the test itself might be worthless and be giving a false result, giving an incorrect result. And it's not wishful thinking on behalf of those who want to see this whole lockdown thing disappear. It's a fact. And what's even more astonishing about that is that today, a woman called Margaret Harris, who's a doctor and who is a spokeswoman for the World Health Organization, she was going on television here in the UK saying that she wants testing to become the norm forever. Forever. Literally, forever. Because, and I don't like people who say literally, ordinarily. Because, as she says, we're going to have more potentially deadly pandemics in the future. Let's just make testing a normal thing. And she says this on Sky News to Adam Bolton.
Well, certainly looking at those numbers in those presentation and the stratification by age group, the testing is teaching you so much more than was known in the UK when the first big surge occurred. You're in a much better position to understand what is happening. Now, every country is struggling with needing to ramp up the testing and also the tracking and tracing. Some countries, authorities may have thought this was a temporary measure. This should be a permanent measure because getting it right now means that it will be right in the future. We don't think this is the last time we're going to see a virus that threatens humanity. So this is a time when we all must get better and better at this.
Yeah.
Thank you very much indeed for joining us from the World Health.
Yeah, and he thanks her and lets her go rather than bring her back to what she said and say to her, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? You want us to live out the rest of our lives being tested regularly to see what we might have at any given time?
Because getting it right now means that it will be right in the future. We don't think this is the last time we're going to see a virus.
It's astonishing stuff, really, isn't it? What she says.
Some countries, authorities may have thought this was a temporary measure. This should be a permanent measure.
A permanent measure. Testing going forward, forever and ever. Amen. 25 minutes past the hour. I was listening to BBC Radio 5 Live this morning and, would you believe it, the co-presenters of that programme, Nikki Campbell and Rachel Burden, were actually lamenting the fact that both of them witnessed people flouting the rules over the weekend and they themselves didn't speak up.
Maybe the flouters are doubters, but I didn't say anything. But uncharacteristically, I kept my counsel, Rachel.
When specifically?
When I saw people flouting it in the pub.
Well, I know. And like I said, I didn't say anything with this big group of people in the pub on Saturday night and someone saying, why? Why didn't you go over? I don't know. I was there for a quiet evening with a few girlfriends and I just...
And she seemingly saw seven people at a table in a pub and she is admonishing herself for not going over.
I didn't want it to become a confrontation, so I didn't. And I didn't think it was my place. I thought it was something that the pub should manage.
Yeah.
It's difficult. Anyway, it's really difficult.
It's difficult. Be Jesus, it's difficult. It's terrible. Welcome to Monday's Richie Allen Radio Show. How you doing? Are you well? The 21st of September. In about 3-4 minutes' time, Dr. Vernon Coleman will join us. Looking forward to that. Lots to talk about with Vernon, of course. Later on in the programme, David Vance will join us live from Northern Ireland. In the meantime, this is Coldplay. The tune is called Clocks. 29 minutes past the hour. That is Coldplay and Clocks on the Richie Allen Radio Show, live from Salford. Another beautiful day. What a few days it's been. Nice again tomorrow, and then it gets a bit cooler later in the week. Let's welcome back to the programme the host of An Old Man in a Chair, which you can watch and download and share with others by going to brandnewtube.com. He sold millions and millions of books around the world, a former GP, of course, and a national newspaper columnist. Great friend. It's good to say that these days. Let's welcome back to the programme the one and only Vernon Coleman. Vernon, welcome back. I hope you're well.
I'm well, thank you.
Not too shabby. I had a lovely afternoon in Ramsbottom yesterday, what do they call it again? The monument there, the Peel Monument. So it's nice. Something you said this, I think, in one of your wonderful episodes of An Old Man in a Chair, getting out and having some fresh air, getting to the woods or to the parks. It's a great thing. It's good for the soul. So, yeah, I'm in good form. I really am. Brilliant piece on VernonColeman.com. I've put links out to it. We'll talk about it in a few minutes. The Way We Will Win This War by Dr. Vernon Coleman. Obviously, the only place to start today is the presentation by Chris Whitty and Patrick Vallance, Chief Government Advisors, this morning from Downing Street extraordinarily, which was devoid of any political presence, no government person there, and no journalists were there to ask questions, nor were they remotely able to link in and pose any questions at all. What did you make of this today?
Well, anything that these two say, I have to confess I regard with so much scepticism that it sort of goes in one ear and the other. The Vallance, of course, was the director and senior executive at our friends GlaxoSmithKline, GSK, and we've talked about them before and the amazing track record they have and the fact that they're the last I heard, they had the biggest fraud claim against them. And these are the people who are probably going to be making the vaccine. The claims that we're all going to have a terrible autumn and winter were predictable so long ago. In fact, I wrote a piece about 3 months ago, or did a video about 3 months ago, saying why they need a second wave. Well, of course they need a second wave, because too many people are getting a bit blasé, and so they've got to keep the pressure up. And the only way to do that is to keep the frightening up, because that's the classic. This is all part of the brainwashing, part of the keeping us quiet, keeping us terrified so that we don't actually notice what the devil's going on, except for the fear. There was an amazing piece on our favourite stupid website yesterday, the BBC, which was headlined, New Coronavirus Rules Inevitable. And the guy who wrote it interviewed four lots of people, I think it was, to find out the general public's view. And I have never seen anything that I found more depressing than this amazing set of interviews. The first lot of people said that there was no social distancing in a pub, so they left. They thought that was terrible. They were on a week's holiday. The second lot of people was somebody who said, it's going to have to happen. This is the shutdowns, the lockdowns. It's going to have to happen because people don't care. People don't see it as a threat. The third person said, a second lockdown might not be the worst thing if it helps protect vulnerable people. The fourth lot of people said, they were from Greece, and they said, I was really surprised when I came here. You're in Tesco, say, so many people are not wearing masks, and nobody is challenging them. London needs to wake up to the coronavirus. This is so scary. It's these people that need to wake up, because they've been indoctrinated. And Whitty and Vallance, of course, are part of the, whatever they might claim, in my view, they're part of the government's propaganda scheme, which is to frighten the bejesus out of us all so that we give in to whatever they bring in next, whatever lockdown, social distancing, or we all have to walk down the street with a mince pie on our heads. Some people would do anything in order to further their government's aims. They've just become totally besotted with everything the Hancock says. I find it quite frightening, actually, Richie, that so many people have taken the garbage, have swallowed the Kool-Aid, have believed the rubbish that they're being told, because it is rubbish. And evidence clearly shows that it's rubbish. And the media's been bought and sold, hasn't it?
Yeah, it has been. It has been. You've got co-presenters on national radio this morning discussing, kind of annoyed with themselves that they didn't challenge people yesterday when they were out and about, you know, for not sticking to the rule of six. The media has fallen. You have James O'Brien on LBC telling us that we really should trust Whitty and Vallance and we all need to be in it together. Very little apart from Julia Hartley Brewer, who had an incredibly interesting exchange with Grant Shapps, the Transport Secretary. And this is very important, I think. You got to give some kudos here to Desmond Swain. Now, you, of course, have been talking about the false positives and the pretty shabby testing mechanism and why it's flawed and the tests are picking up any. You put it beautifully last week. You said that these tests are finding any bits of bugs and viruses because we carry them all the time anyway and are giving a positive. And Desmond Swain seems to have opened up a big can of worms, the Conservative MP for New Forest West, because he's been able to point out, and he put this to Hancock last week, and it's really, today it came up on the Brewer Show, the Hartley Brewer Show, that the Office of National Statistics has basically acknowledged that if 1.37% of everyone tested is positive, and they then admitted that false positives are at around about 2.4% at the moment, well, that blows the whole thing out of the water. And Brewer hammered Chaps with this morning, and she said, look, ultimately the statistics are showing that 9 out of 10 people who show positive for COVID might actually be, those 9 out of 10 might actually not be positive at all. And sadly, it was only talk radio that picked up on this today. But I don't know what more mileage we can get out of it. You've been talking about this for some time, Vernon.
The testing is being done solely and simply, in my opinion, just to excuse the lockdowns, because the garbage that's being talked. There was one yesterday on Yahoo News. I didn't even know there was a thing called Yahoo News, but it was, and the headline was, "You are more likely to win the lottery than escape COVID-19 infection," warns WHO expert. I hope they cleared it with Uncle Bill, of course. Now, the story, when you look at it, this is talking about the figures that you were just talking about. And the quote from this guy is, "If we don't find a vaccine and we don't continue suppressing this virus, and we assume, I always love that word by a scientist, and we assume that the virus spreads to 60 or 70% of the population in the world, that's effectively 1 in 200 affected with COVID-19 on this planet. From that perspective, think of your chances of winning the lottery," which is where they got the headline from. "You're more likely to win the lottery than escape a COVID-19 infection." Now, the reason I mention this is it's just another example of how they produce false news. Because you look at the lottery, and the UK Euro Millions lottery, I checked this, you've got a 1 in 139 million chance of winning that. So are they really saying that you've only got a 1 in 139 million chance of not getting the COVID-19 infection? Because that's what the headline says. And that's such garbage. I mean, they attack us, those of us who doubt the sanctity of the whole thing. They attack us for false news. And one of the things, I've spent all day investigating this, because they've been saying that the claims that the RNA DNA vaccine will affect our genome and could affect the genome and could therefore cause a change in the human being for eternity. They're saying that's all garbage, and that's all the fake news, false news people, they've all been out screaming and shouting. And I've been investigating it, and I am even more terrified now, because I believe the flu vaccine, which they're going to bring in, that's pretty certain that's going to be an RNA DNA vaccine. It's not going to be one of the old-fashioned ones where they just either kill something or kill something a bit and hope it's all right. It's going to be an RNA DNA vaccine. Now, this is when it gets really, really quite scary, because when you look at all the genetic stuff, can I just go into the vaccine in a minute? But before that, just talk about a couple of other things which relate to the flu vaccine and relate to the false news stuff.
By all means, go ahead.
Thanks, mate. First, we all know about the Gates mosquitoes and the problems with those, but I dug one out that I hadn't seen before. I'd been meaning to look at it for ages, and I hadn't got round to it. It was some genetically modified cows in Australia, and they bred a dairy cow with no horns, because taking the horns off is a pain for everybody concerned. And they managed to breed a dairy cow with no horns.
We've lost Vernon momentarily, have we?
But it wasn't.
We lost you. We lost you just when you said they managed to breed dairy cows with no horns, and then you just dropped out. But you're back.
Okay.
Now.
Well, they managed to breed these with no horns, which was obviously good for the cow and good for the farmers, because they didn't have to take them off. And the people who did it managed to get some authorities think it was in Brazil, to because they tried everywhere, and somebody in Brazil said it wasn't genetically modified, it was just gene edited. So that was all right. And then some American investigator, looking at what they'd done, found that the DNA included a mistake. The DNA that they'd put into the cows, the things that they'd done to the cows, and the DNA of the cow now included DNA from a type of bacterium. And so technically, the cattle were not cattle. They were part cow, part bacterium.
Hybrid.
Now, this tech was, which is pretty scary, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, a hybrid. You have a hybrid animal, then.
You have a hybrid between a cow and a bacterium.
Yeah.
Now, what's scary here is because what they're planning to do with these vaccines, and obviously the COVID-19 is going to be an RNA DNA, and the almost certainly the flu vaccine that they are pushing so hard. I saw some actor today was pushing it. I mean, heaven knows what he knows about vaccines, probably as much as I know about acting. But
yeah,
he was pushing it, and the thing is that the RNA DNA vaccine takes part of the virus's own genetic information, which is enough to create an immune response. Now, we've had all sorts of problems really recently with vaccines. As you know, in Africa, the Gates WHO polio vaccine ended up, most of the cases of polio in that part of the world are actually caused by the polio vaccine. It's their breed, it's their type of polio. And the problem with the RNA DNA vaccine is frightening the life out of me, because basically we have to trust Witte, Valence, and the drug companies. Now we have to trust, you have to put your faith and your life and your humanity in the big drug companies, AstraZeneca and GSK, being very careful and making sure that they're doing it right. Now, the way the DNA RNA vaccine works is it makes the immune system think it's under attack, and it triggers the production of proteins in the cells, and then eventually you get the stimulated T cells. Now, the World Health Organization, and this is a bit of a killer, because the World Health Organization is, of course, a great promoter of vaccines. The World Health Organization has said, in relation to DNA vaccines, and I quote, "Many aspects of the immune responses caused by DNA vaccines are not yet fully understood." Close quotes. Now, despite this, we're going to carry on, and what they're going to do is put DNA, RNA vaccines into everybody. Now, there's a Professor Gilbert who's at Oxford, who's a professor of vaccinology, and she says that these vaccines don't alter a person's DNA at all. They provide a temporary addition in a small number of cells. DNA vaccines do not enter the genome. But there's a guy called Peter Doherty who is also been talking about this, and he says that we're not going to, I'm just trying to get the quote right, because he's a professor of immunology, and he says, we're not going to copy the genetic material back into the human genome. But quite frankly, and I'm quoting him, if you made an RNA vaccine and you gave it to people and it transmitted to other people, in other words, the next generation, that would be a good thing. That would be a good thing.
A good thing.
Isn't that fantastic? It's so we're not going to do it, but it would be a good thing. And you can trust us. Just trust us. It'll be all right. Don't worry. Now, the other thing, the other killer about this, is that the people who are doing this have admitted, and here again, this is a direct quote, there would be a requirement to do follow-up research, and if that research fails to confirm these indications, in other words, that it's safe, then the drug or the vaccine can be withdrawn. That's what they usually do. But this one, they want to give to everybody all at once.
Yeah.
And what they're saying now is, you're only likely to see, they've admitted that you're only likely to see the full effects of a vaccine once it's out into the community, because you have to give it to huge numbers of people before you start seeing side effects. So if 100 people in a million die, then just giving it to a few thousand, you're not going to pick that up. And that's always the problem with vaccines. That's why they have paid out, the American government's paid out $4 billion. And don't forget the drug companies and Hong Kong stuff. So it's all perfectly safe. Don't worry, nothing ever goes wrong. Why are you paying out billions of dollars if there's nothing that goes wrong? But there's, as Doherty puts it, this is a professor of immunology who's doing all this stuff. As he puts it, it's all one enormous experiment. People are trying to be safe, but even a partially effective vaccine might be useful. Now, I particularly like, it's all one enormous experiment. People are trying to be safe. So what we've got is an RNA-DNA vaccine, which is going to be put into your cells with bits of a virus, and they tell us, oh, we're not trying to change the human genome. But what we've seen in the past is they weren't trying to change the genome of the cow. They weren't trying to muck up when they messed around with the mosquitoes. But things didn't go too well, and things often don't go too well when you start doing genetic engineering, genetic modification, whatever you want to call it.
And don't forget, Vernon, they're in the middle of what I believe to be a massive cover-up over the effects of Gardasil on some young women who get it. And yeah. I feel confident in saying that. I do my level best to never say anything in terms of, with any finality, unless I know for a fact. But I believe those women in Ireland and their families, and I believe the women in the Far East, and I believe the women in Scandinavia whose lives have been turned upside down after receiving the Gardasil, the HPV vaccine, yeah. You know, and that's still going on, and of course nobody wants to touch that in the media. So why should any human being listening to what Doherty said, listening to Valance today, why should any human being be compelled to take something that's rushed out in a few months that they admit themselves they don't really know what sort of effects it's going to have on people? How could you possibly try to coerce somebody into taking it then? But yet they're going to do that.
Yeah, and I think that if they make it mandatory in any sense, in other words, mandatory in the, well, we're not going to let you go to hospital sense,
yeah,
or we're not going to let you get on an aeroplane sense, if they make it mandatory, I think somebody goes to court, we have a crowd justicing, justice, whatever, people go to court. There has got to be, most of the Human Rights Act has been eradicated, the bit that gives you freedom of speech and stuff, that's long gone. But if you go to court and say, they are trying to force me to have a vaccine and they cannot tell me what it's going to do to me in a year's time. Because a lot of the problems with these vaccines, as you know, they don't appear until a year, 5 years, 10 years down the line. That's why it takes that long to create a new vaccine. That's why the people who are checking vaccines, who are making sure they're safe, and don't forget, the government has said, oh, well, we're not going to take any notice of EU licensing laws as far as vaccines are concerned, but you just have to trust us, it'll be all right. You're going to have to trust us, it'll be all right. We're going to give it to everybody. It won't matter a damn if it isn't all right, because everybody will be dead or injured or changed.
Can we go back to flu for a minute? I want to play a short audio clip. I hope you can hear this. And the reason I say that is because I know you're on the old-fashioned dog and bone. If you were speaking to me some other way, it might be easier. I'm pretty sure you will be able to hear it clearly. It's just an amazing bit of audio from Anne Diamond. You're old enough to remember Anne Diamond, Dr. Vernon Coleman.
I was the PVAM doctor.
I know, you were there, that's right, with Nick Owen and Anne Diamond. Of course you were. So I think Anne is lovely. I'm not just saying, I think she's a lovely lady. And she does the newspaper reviews for Sky on every second Sunday morning. She goes on there with Michael Booker, the editor of the Sunday Express. And she had a very interesting story that she found in the Sunday Times about how flu has seemingly disappeared in Australia. I think you'll find this very interesting, and I'm sure you'll be able to hear it. Have a listen. It's brief. Anne Diamond talking about the flu disappearing in Australia. Have a listen to this.
Yes, this is a really interesting story, actually. In the countries in the Southern Hemisphere, where obviously they're coming out of winter, they have experienced much, much lower rates of ordinary flu. The R value for ordinary flu has really plummeted. In some countries, they're not experiencing it at all. In Australia, where, for instance, they would have expected during a normal winter to lose about 1,000 people to ordinary flu, 40 this time. In New Zealand, they have hardly had a case at all. Now, you ask yourself why, and the scientist is saying it's because of social distancing and all of the measures that we've put in place to combat coronavirus.
Now, flu has disappeared. Go on.
Richie, can you hear me?
Loud and clear.
Okay, mate. I spotted this weeks ago, and I looked at the figures for Australia, and boy, are they fun. Because last year, the number of people who died of flu in Australia, I'm guessing, I haven't got the figures in front of me, but these are very close approximation. The number of people who died of the flu last year in Australia was an amazingly low 440. This year, the number of people who've died of the flu in Australia is about 40, and the number of people who've died of COVID-19 in Australia this year is 400. Now, what do you get if you add 440? You get last year's flu deaths. All they've done is renumbered them as COVID deaths. It's exactly the same. You add the flu and the COVID numbers together, and it's exactly the same as they get every year.
Wow.
So that's an amazing piece of what the doctors tend to call bollocks.
Is that a scientific term?
Yeah, I try not to use too many scientific terms.
It is, though, isn't it? And Anne is a very capable woman. I genuinely believe that she wasn't self-censoring. I genuinely believe that it didn't occur to her that they would just be recategorizing the flu as COVID. I'm not more intelligent than Anne Diamond. I know I'm not. I'd say we're about the same, about equal. But it occurred to me straight away, you know, mad.
Yeah, well, I've got the figures that prove it.
Yeah.
The problem is, of course, was the Sunday Times doing printing that and not saying, hey, hang on a minute, if you add A and B, you get C, which was last year's. I mean, it's not exactly terribly difficult science.
Yeah, but I have a theory. My theory is there are one or two Trojans, and I don't mean Trojan horses. I think within the newspapers there are still one or two bloody good journalists, and they've got a box a bit clever. I think whoever put that article up for editing and got it into the paper knew damn well what was going on, but they couldn't say it bluntly. That's just my guess. I could be wrong, though.
So they were hoping we'd point it out for them.
Maybe. Somebody like you, yeah. Or maybe somebody would pick it up in Westminster, maybe.
Well, who knows? Somebody who's not got drug company money in their back pocket.
Yeah.
I don't know. What amazes me about Westminster is, didn't we used to have an opposition party? Didn't we used to have people who used to stand up in Parliament
at one time
and shout at the Prime Minister when they thought he was doing something a bit iffy, or ask him why he was doing something a bit iffy, or point out some facts that he might not have noticed? Didn't we have one of those?
At one time.
Where's it gone?
Do you think it was symbolic today? Do you think it was symbolic that Whitty and Vallance seemed to be given the run of number 10 Downing Street? It was almost like subliminally telling the public, forget about your politicians, we're running things now.
Absolutely, yeah. And as I've said a million times, I am terribly worried. Why is a former vaccine manufacturer, and a high-level one, he wasn't just some punter working there in the office carrying the post around, he was a director of GlaxoSmithKline. And I mean, I've recited ad nauseam, I won't do it again, but to your great relief, I've recited ad nauseam the billions of dollars that GlaxoSmithKline have paid in fines for getting things wrong, hiding things, whatever. They even got fined by the Chinese for bribery. And all that time, Vallance was there. And now we're expected to believe that this guy is on our side. Actually, I'd quite like somebody who didn't have any connection. I'd like to know what his connection is. Does he get a pension from GlaxoSmithKline? Be pretty strange if he didn't. Does he have, what financial connection does he have? And then dear old Whitty, I mean, we know he has a financial connection with Bill Gates. You know, he didn't take money directly, but the money that went to the organization he was working for. What was it, $40
million? Yeah, $40
million. Some of that, presumably, if he was working there, the Gates money goes everywhere, doesn't it? The Gates money's in the BBC, the Gates money's in the Guardian. I had a feeling that that BBC guy who interviewed those people who were all saying, oh, we need more lockdowns, isn't it terrible? We went in the pub, people weren't social distancing. I think he just stopped people in the street who were carrying the Guardian because he knew he was onto a good thing. It's easy, isn't it?
Well, if you're ever bored, I say to our dear listener, if you're ever bored of a Sunday afternoon, play a lovely game, take out your computer and put random universities into the search engine of your choice, be it Google, and put the name of Bill Gates alongside the random university, and you will find, and it's never failed for me, you will find a link to a story talking about how that university received money from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. It's an astonishing thing. Let me remind our listeners before you talk about other things, I want to talk about the leaflets, because a lot of our listeners have taken up the mantle, they've taken up the baton, and they have been going on to vernoncoleman.com. They have been taking the text that you've prepared. They've made their leaflets and they've been tweeting to me and I've been retweeting it. It's a wonderful thing. Before you talk about that, folks, Vernon Coleman, Dr. Vernon Coleman, can be seen regularly on brandnewtube.com. An old man and a chair is about the best thing to happen to the media in 2020. It was on YouTube to begin with, but they had the terrible habit of censoring and deleting videos that they didn't like, and that was most of them. So we got fed up of that, and he went to Brand New Tube, where there is no censorship. Incredibly qualified, as we've gotten into at the very beginning of this conversation. I won't reiterate his credentials. So brandnewtube.com is where you'll find Vernon Coleman, an old man in a chair, and vernoncoleman.com. Enter the website. On the left-hand side, click Health, and you will see a lot of information, articles, transcripts of shows, of presentations Vernon has done, and you will find links to the text so that you can make your own leaflets. It's a lovely lovely article on there. I read it this morning. The way we will win this war, and you talk about, obviously, the lack of journalism, what's happened to the media, you've just discussed that today. Then you talk about the problem with social media, and you neatly conclude, and you're absolutely right, that the leaflets are very, very, very useful. And you want people to take up the challenge and use some of their spare time to hand some of these out.
I think it's the only way we can do it now. The mainstream media, as most people know now, has been bought, owned lock, stock and barrel, largely through the government throwing huge amounts of our money at newspapers and so on, for advertising government propaganda. And the BBC, of course, has always been bought, but it's got even more bought now, I think, because they're terrified of losing their license fee or whatever. But the fact is that you have to know, if you're fighting a war, which I believe we are, and I believe we're fighting a war against our own governments, not just in Europe, but all around the world, everybody is fighting a war against their government. But obviously you've got to know who your enemies are, and you've got to know what they're doing, and you've got to know what their strengths are and what our strengths are. Well, the enemy has bought the mass media. They've bought the newspapers. They've bought the TV. They've bought most of that stuff. And we've lost an enormous amount of the internet because, as you said, YouTube's took down about over a quarter of my videos, and they took down three in one day, and it was just getting silly. I wasn't allowed to say anything that contradicted, basically, that contradicted anything Bill Gates said, which I thought peeved me a bit, because I was using massive amounts of research and digging out original papers, and Bill's trying to flog a vaccine.
Yeah.
And his value, his view, is apparently far more valuable than medical researchers and people writing on masks and so on, because the mask information is vastly, just basically shows that masks do an awful lot of harm and can and will and have kill people. And yet, oh God, I saw a thing that Victoria Beckham got a nine-year-old daughter wearing a mask made out of the same material as her dress. Oh, for heaven's sake, what the point of that? I mean, it's just turning it into a fashion item, for heaven's sakes. Wear your chains in pretty colours. It's scary, but I think the only thing we've got left is to go back a couple of hundred years to leaflets, pamphleteering. I put together a pile of different leaflets on different issues with all the facts in them, so that people who don't realize what's going on and who are only aware of what they're being told by the mainstream media can actually look and see. And at the bottom of the leaflets, I say, look, check it all out. Have a look. We've got some links on the website, but we're trying to get on as many as we can. It's a very up-to-date website, I'll have you know. It was updated in 2002, so I'm really pleased with that.
It's an antique in internet terms. It's an antique. But anyway, it's still very user-friendly.
Museum, which I thought was a bit cheeky, but there you go. But I know it sounds... some people will think it's a bit old-fashioned to do leaflets, but what the devil else is there? We can't force people... I mean, obviously, I want people to spread the videos, I want people to listen to your radio program, and so on, but the only... it's difficult to go up to somebody in a shop and say, hey, look, listen to this radio watch. If you give them a leaflet, you might trigger them into starting to ask some questions. Is that what we need to do?
Yeah.
We need people to ask questions. Why am I wearing a mask when the evidence shows that the mask is going to do me a lot of harm and won't do me any good at all? Why are they trying to get rid of cash? It's nothing to do with the fact that cash might be a bit dirty. Cash has always been a bit dirty. Nobody worried about it before. The reason for getting rid of cash is to make us all reliant on the banks so that they can turn us off, like those smart meters that they're bringing in, so that they're even better than the last lot of smart meters, so that they can cut off your boiler, cut off your electric car, cut off your telly, cut off anything they like, especially if you've been a bad person. You know, that Richie Allen, he's a bad person, turn his electricity off.
Yeah.
It's scary, because this is no longer... it's no longer something that you can just do for an hour a week. This is if we're fighting this, this is our life. This is a battle for survival. And I hate to sound as if I'm exaggerating, but I'm not. I honestly believe that. And I was triggered a bit. I've got a leaflet next to my desk, which I picked up on Elba once, and it's a leaflet Napoleon threw to the... he sent, when Napoleon left Elba and was going back to Paris, they sent the entire French army to pick him up and arrest him or shoot him or whatever they wanted to do. And Napoleon had somebody passing these leaflets to the soldiers. And the leaflet just starts off, soldiers, I'm your emperor, blah, blah, blah. And they passed all these leaflets, and the soldiers just lined up behind Napoleon, and he led them back into Paris. The power of the leaflet is quite incredible. And if you get people to just look at them, people have shops. Put them in people's bags. Put them in a box by the door. Just spread them around. Put them through people's letterboxes. Is that still legal? Can you put...
It is still legal, and I'll tell you why I think you're right. All the major political parties, they still engage in posting bills, leaflets, pamphlets through your door, through your letterbox on a regular basis. And they've got some of the... you know, they've got strategists and advisors who will understand the impact of leaflets, and if it didn't do any good, they wouldn't do it. I think you're absolutely right. Can I play another 30 seconds of a clip? Can I? I love playing new clips. I'm guessing you didn't watch Andrew Marr yesterday morning, did you?
I didn't, no. Why would I do that?
Well, I'm not trying to contradict you, because you're right, the media is gone. But Marr, something woke Marr up yesterday, and he went after Hancock, not in the Jeremy Paxman style, but he went after him about lockdowns. And it's good, because Hancock was squirming all over the place. And just have a listen. It's not very long. Dr. Vernon Coleman with us for another 10 minutes or thereabouts. I want to have a listen to this. This is the Andrew Marr Show, flagship of BBC One Sunday morning show. Here he is interviewing the Health Secretary, Matt Hancock, yesterday about the necessity of lockdowns and their usefulness.
There is an argument that actually these local lockdowns, lockdowns generally, don't work nearly as well as we hoped they would at the beginning of all of this. Professor Mark Woolhouse, who was a member of one of your government's advisory groups, said this week. He said it's profoundly disappointing that 6 months into this pandemic, having rejected every alternative proposed, we keep coming back to lockdown, a strategy that is visibly failing around the world.
Well, unfortunately, that analysis it doesn't learn the lessons of recent history. We've seen, firstly, we do know that lockdowns work. They are our last line of defence, and we do not want to do it. But of course they work, because we saw it work in the spring. Secondly, we have taken local action, mm-hmm. and that has brought cases right under control in places like Luton and Herefordshire and Norfolk.
Let me ask you about Oldham, where you've had a very tough series of local restrictions now for 4 weeks, and where the rate of infection in that time has doubled.
Well, clearly the enforcement needs to go further and needs to be stronger.
He sounds like such a lawyer, doesn't he, in terms of his faltering, stuttering delivery?
He doesn't know what he's talking about, does he? He doesn't understand that there isn't any evidence that lockdowns worked. The government itself has admitted that the lockdowns killed far more people than the COVID is ever likely to kill. And let's remember that compared to flu globally, COVID is just a little bit of nothing. He also ignores the fact that the lockdowns are being introduced as a result of infections, not deaths. The death rate's been going down. Scotland went, 3 people died in a day. They should have a look and see how many people die falling off horses or die falling off stilettos or whatever. But, I mean, it's crazy to create national policies on the basis of how many people have got a disease based on how many people have tested positive. First, because the tests, as has been proven time and time again around the world, are useless. And secondly, because you don't measure a disease by the incidence, you measure a disease by the significance. And I mean, you could say, I mean, dandruff's probably commoner than COVID-19. Are we going to close down the entire country because a lot of people have got dandruff or athlete's feet or whatever?
Yeah.
No, we don't close down whole parts of the world for a disease or a problem that doesn't kill a lot of people. We have to know that it's killing a lot of people. And COVID-19 is plainly not killing a lot of people. And I'm glad Ma gave him a little bit of a workout, but I wish somebody had given him a proper workout, because the guy burst into tears and run out of the studio, tearing his microphone off and run away and hide, because I don't think he knows. I don't think he knows anything. I don't even think he knows that the whole thing's a fake, because I did a video the other day saying that everything they're doing everything that seems to be, I can't remember what the title was, but basically the principle was everything they're doing is on purpose.
It's on purpose,
nothing, nothing is by accident. They're doing all this because they've planned it. They've planned everything. You have to believe that. If you're not a complete idiot, you have to believe that. I'm sorry, I'm not being rude to people, but, well, I am, I suppose. But the fact of the matter is that COVID, just about every senior doctor in the world will agree that the death rate with COVID-19 is virtually identical to the death rate with flu. The flu affects more people. COVID, when you actually take out the figures that are false, and don't forget that in this country they still count it as a COVID death if you tested positive, which means that you might not have it, but you tested positive. If you die within 28 days, you died of COVID-19. If somebody beats you over the head with a brick, if somebody runs you over with a bus, you don't die of being beaten over the head with a brick or being run over by a bus if within the previous 28 days you tested positive. In that case, you died of COVID-19. And until they changed it recently, because the figures for the UK were getting so scary, it was any time ever you tested for COVID-19, tested for the coronavirus, then you died of that. And in America, when they changed the figures, the fact checkers had a wonderful time with this, because the fact is that in America, the CDC said originally the American figures were quite bad, and the CDC looked at them, and eventually they admitted, without apparently any shame, they admitted that 94% of the people who had allegedly died of COVID-19 actually had two or three other serious things wrong with them. And so really only 6% of the people who had really died of COVID-19 had really died of COVID-19. Now, if you look at the flu figures, and right at the start of this, back in February, March, I pointed out that in a flu season, up to 650,000 people die in the world. 650,000 people die in the world. Now, I don't know what today's figure for the world for COVID-19 is. I think it's about 800,000. But you and I and everybody listening knows that that figure is wildly exaggerated because they're using the 28 days or did you ever or you coughed or sneezed, therefore you died of COVID-19. Yeah. In other words, the death total worldwide, I would bet, is considerably less than the death total from the flu.
Hey, by the way, don't forget yesterday, the Mail on Sunday. And there are many reasons to doubt the Mail on Sunday. So I was able to verify this using the search engine. But Oxford University research suggests that of those allegedly killed by COVID in July and August this year, at least one third of them actually died of other causes. According to the Mail on Sunday, and again, I was able to independently verify this before my Sunday morning show yesterday, that basically people with cancer or being hit by a car or being in an accident were actually signed off as having died of COVID. This is astonishing to me, that this could happen.
But it has to be part of a plan, Richie. There's no other explanation. Either if it was happening in one country, you could say, oh, just a lot of loonies, really daft people. But you go back to the care homes that we've talked about before. People from hospitals, old people were thrown into care homes, and tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands around the world died. The significant factor in all this is that exactly the same thing happened everywhere. Now, you could say, if it had only happened in the UK, you could say, well, it was just some stupid hospital administrators sending people into care homes, frightening the life out of the staff, and then the end result was a lot of deaths of elderly people who died because they weren't being fed properly and they weren't getting medical care because doctors decided not. It was too dangerous to go in and treat them. God, well, that's awful, that is. Doctors saying, oh, it's too dangerous to go into the care home or the nursing home. We'll have to leave old people to die.
Terrible, yeah.
And putting DNR notices on anybody over 65. If you live in Scotland, it's 45. Anybody over 65. Just think of the things that people over 65 have done with their lives and the majestic things that we wouldn't have. Just the composers, the authors, the whatever, artists. A lot of their major work done after the age of 65. But kill them all, because they're old and useless. We don't want them.
Not to mention the fact that they laboured under the understanding that working their fingers to the bone and paying national insurance and income tax, that when they got to a stage when they needed some help, the understanding was that they'd paid for it. Absolutely. It sickens me, and I'm not grandstanding here at all. I hate this. And the knowledge, of course, you know, that people, senior citizens have the experience. You said it yourself, the life experiences. It's sinister beyond belief. Why would you put a DNR notice on somebody? I mean, where does that... I covered Liverpool Care Pathway on this programme years ago. Some of the stuff I've come across over the years, and you've researched this far more than I have. I mean, I'm just, I'm a boy compared to you. Some of the things I've uncovered and seen, I can't believe it, you know? Still, to this day, I shake my head. Anyway.
It's terrifying, the things that they're doing. And when you stop and look at it all and try and look at it from a bit of a distance, you can see that, and then almost all the bizarre, indefensible things that have happened in recent years. For example, talking doctors' hospitals, the General Medical Council, which is a charity, believe it or not, the General Medical Council in the UK, which I believe is responsible for far more deaths than Harold Shipman, the General Medical Council said, has introduced a thing called revalidation, which means that, they did this allegedly in response to Shipman. The idea was that in order to prove that you're a good doctor, you have to get, I think it's 30 or a certain number of patients to sign a document saying you're a good doctor. Now, how many patients faced with their doctor and a piece of paper are going to say, oh, he's a shitty doctor, I'm not going to sign that doctor, you're useless.
Yeah.
Of course, you'll get. But what it did was it meant that doctors who were retired couldn't revalidate, because doctors who are retired, usually they do a week or two locum here, or they do a bit in an emergency, or if one of the partners in a practice where they used to work is ill, they'll go and stand in for a month or two. That's how it's always worked. What the GMC ruling did on this revalidation nonsense, all it did was it meant that once a doctor had retired, he could no longer have a license. And when at the beginning of this hoax, scandal, fiasco, fraud, whatever you call it, the beginning of that, the government suddenly realized or said that they were going to be short of doctors, and so they wanted some older doctors to come out of retirement, and they suddenly realized that they'd rather shot themselves in the foot because the older doctors couldn't have licenses. What they did was they said, oh, well, you can have a license, you can have a temporary license, we'll give you one without any of the revalidation nonsense. And that alone has taken away so much experience, because doctors who have 30, 40 years experience have been taken out of the equation completely. And I think that was all part of the dumbing down of medicine, the creating of a bizarre world in which a senior representative of doctors said that GPs wouldn't be able to work more than one day a week because it was too stressful for them. Doctors working less working hours than librarians, and even shut in for lunchtime. I mean, for heaven's sake, you can go into the library at lunchtime, but your doctor's probably shut. And currently, practices all over the country, GPs basically shutting their doors. They were actually told by the NHS the other day, open your doors, stop being so lazy, which really annoyed them, I think. But the fact is that when you look at all these things, they all start to fit a pattern, a pattern of destroying our society. And you think, well, that who would want to do that? Go back to Agenda 21.
Can we get into that next week? The who?
Yeah.
Not the World Health Organization, but the who or what is behind it.
I've been looking at that for
years,
for a week now, because it was clear there was something behind it. And I know what it is now. And it is truly scary, because the future, if we don't win this war, and I'd no apologies for calling it a war. I think of it as a war. If we don't win this war, we're stuffed. We're finished. We're slaves. We're either dead or we're slaves. You won't be a human being, because what I was talking about previously with about vaccines, that really, I really believe that.
And the flu
vaccine, I think, is going to be just as bad as the COVID vaccine, because it's going to be an RNA DNA vaccine. And I remind you, the World Health Organization said, we don't really know terribly much. I'm paraphrasing. We don't really know terribly much about this, all right, yet. But it'll be all right. We just have to trust the drug companies. If you trust the drug companies to look after you, to make sure that you're safe and well protected, then good luck to you. I'm on a different bus, mate.
We will pick it up again next week on that. Just before you go, as quick as you can, if you don't mind, I am due to have another guest on shortly. VernonColeman.com, print out the leaflets. Dr. Vernon Coleman, an old man in a chair, on brandnewtube.com. Quick plug for an old man in a chair.
Thank you, Richie. Thank you very much.
No.
We're the only public service channel left in Britain. Because the BBC is now a voice for Bill Gates and the EU and all sorts of rubbish, by the way.
Sadly.
I'm a public service channel, mate. And no licence fee. You don't have to pay a licence fee.
You don't have to pay to watch an old man in a chair, and he doesn't take any money from anybody either. There's no advertising. Vernon, thanks so much. Have a great week. I'm sure we'll talk in the week. Our listeners can expect you back at 5:30 next Monday. Thanks, as always. A real pleasure.
Thank you very much, Richie. Pleasure talking to you.
Thank you. Dr. Vernon Coleman there, vernoncoleman.com. Get on to the website and do, if you've got the time, if you've got the, if it's possible for you to go into a town centre or even just pop around your local neighbourhood and post a bill, a pamphlet, a leaflet through someone's letterbox with that text that you can just copy and paste. I think there's a lot to be said for that. And I go back to what I said a short time ago. They wouldn't do it, the big political parties, unless there was something in it. they wouldn't. You know, they've got all sorts of psychologists who look into these things. How do we best reach people? How do we get people to pay attention to stuff? And they're still putting bills, as I said, and leaflets through people's letterboxes. Right. It is the Richie Allen Radio Show. It is 20 minutes past 6 for Monday. It's the 21st of September 2020. I must give a big shout out to Paul Ripley, by the way. I'm not sure if Paul will be listening now. I know he was listening a bit earlier on. He was around today, was Paul. He's a great, great friend of mine. I mentioned him last week when we had the 6th anniversary of the programme. Wonderful bloke. As nice a guy as you could ever meet in your life. A great engineer too. And he was here today fiddling around with the studio and software and stuff like that. It was great to see him. I hadn't seen him in ages. And he's not had a great time for it recently. Paul's mum passed away a week or so ago, and she was laid to rest on Friday last, which wasn't easy for him, of course, and his family. But he got through it. An amazing lady, by all accounts. And so we send all our best to the great Paul Ripley. There wouldn't be any Richie Allen Radio Show if it wasn't for Paul Ripley. That is not a throwaway. I mean that. I wouldn't be here without him. I have got some Van Morrison then. This is Caravan from the amazing Moondance album. Back in a few minutes, hopefully, with another guest. Yeah, Van Morrison there in Caravan from the Moondance album. Terrific tune, that. He's in the news, or he was in the news, wasn't he, over the last week, because apparently on the 25th of September, which is really soon, which I think is Friday, this coming Friday, he drops, do you like that? Do you like the lingo? He drops 3 new tracks. 3 new tracks, and they're all lockdown critical. Van the Man Morrison. Yes, scathingly critical of the lockdown and of the shadowy figures that he suggests might be behind it, and the tyranny of the removal of our freedom. So Van Morrison in the news last week. Yeah, all good. That's on the 25th. Due to be speaking right now with David Vance, the Conservative commentator and broadcaster, but he isn't online. I've tried to raise him via the mobile. No producers here, you see, beavering away in the background. He isn't there. I'll give him a few minutes. We'll see how it goes. And Asher, these are strange times, aren't they? Aren't they strange times? David Vance had his Twitter account deleted about 10 days ago. I was in touch with him at the time. And it came after he had an exchange with the Manchester United superstar, Marcus Rashford. He wasn't a superstar on Saturday, losing 3-1 to Crystal Palace. Although it wasn't Marcus's fault. You couldn't blame Marcus for it. So Marcus Rashford, of course, has made national and international headlines because he took on the government at the outset of the lockdown on school meals for children, for hard-up children, and was able to make the government do a U-turn on a policy where they were going to withdraw. The government was going to withdraw that support. And Marcus Rashford, and I think it's a great thing. I think he did a fantastic thing. I really do. And it was obvious to me anyway. Forget my allegiance to Madchester or Manchester United. It was obvious to me at the time that it meant a lot to him, having grown up in a family that struggled, with a mum who worked a few jobs and barely kept things together for them. And David Vance had an exchange with him about that. And he also had an exchange with David Lammy. Now, David Lammy is a Labour politician. He's black. These days, I think he's got a show on LBC Radio. This is the style of the time now. I told you before, the very worrying thing. It should be of concern to every man, woman and child, that rather than challenge politicians, rather than grab them by the testicle, grab them by the balls or by the vaginas and squeeze them and ask them some real questions, rather than do that, they're putting these people on the air. I won't, because I'll bore you. I know I will bore you, and I don't want to bore you. I might be a lot of things. I'm not boring ordinarily. But, you know, can you imagine if you spent most of your working life in the media? You never imagined that you would see a time when politicians, some of them sitting MPs, would have a radio show. I mean, it is vaudevillian. That's where we are. But anyway, David Vance, the Conservative commentator, nationalist, got stuck into Marcus Rashford and David Lammy, and Twitter did what Twitter does. It reacted to an outcry. There was a dog pile on David Vance, and he was deleted. I don't want to dwell too much on that. I want to talk about, if we don't get him on today, I'm sure we'll get him on tomorrow or Wednesday. Because he's a businessman, I want to dig down into the economic impact of the lockdown and the measures they are proposing for the next few weeks and the next few months. As you heard explained very eloquently by Dr. Vernon Coleman only a short time ago. It's 6:30 then. It's your Richie Allen radio show. It is the most listened to independent radio show in Europe. Very proud of that as well. Back in a moment with more chat.
Renowned healer Mark Bajerski travels the world to find the most unique and powerful crystals for self-healing. Since the ancient times, crystals have been used as healing tools. They hold a natural healing vibration and are highly charged in positive energy. Mark teaches how to channel the universal energy and transfer it to the crystal to activate its healing power. Each crystal is used for its unique ability to target a different physical or emotional challenge. Mark Bajerski is an author, healer, speaker, and founder of the Pure Energy Healing Academy. He shares powerful messages of inspiration and healing on his daily YouTube videos, reaching millions worldwide. Mark's crystals, healing oils, and incense sticks are most sought after by other healers. His collection is available online at www.markbajerski.com. His work is presented through Lemon House, a company that creates and curates consciously made gifts.
The views and opinions expressed on The Richie Allen Show are those of the guests and the guests alone. They do not necessarily reflect the position of the host or other contributors.
Yeah, I've just heard from David Vance. Sadly, his daughter was involved in a car crash about an hour ago and is pretty shook up but is okay, which is nice to hear. And he's unavailable. We'll pick it up with him in the next day or so. So, his daughter had a crash and is shook up but is unhurt, and nobody in the other vehicle hurt either, which is a good thing. Have you been in a car crash, dear listener? Have you? I've been in two, I think. I was in a car crash. I've been in three. Yes, I've been in three. When I was a very young boy, my mother drove a Hillman Hunter car, a big 4-litre tank of a car. My car enthusiast listeners will know exactly what a Hillman Hunter looked like and what it could do. She crashed. I think she was in the wrong. Nobody hurt. A couple of bumped knees in the back seat. Our knees were bumped up and scraped, but we were okay. And I was in a car with my brother about 20 years ago, and there was a crash. It was his fault. Not serious. Nobody hurt. And you might remember, if you listen to this program, and I'm sure you do remember, I was smacked on Wilmslow Road in Manchester one Wednesday morning as I was going about my business. A woman came from a side street and smacked into my car at about 30 miles an hour, wrote my car off, and I was shaken, but not stirred. It's not a nice thing, is it? It's not a nice thing. The lady, I remember, I told you the story at the time. The lady was wearing the full burqa. And I'm convinced that the lady's peripheral vision was definitely impeded by the wearing of the garment, which I have no problem with. Don't start saying, you big anti-Islamic bigot there, Baldy. Don't even start with that, because I'm not saying that at all. But it was definitely a factor. She denied it, of course. But she was banged to rights. She came flying out of a side street, smacked into me, frightened the bejesus out of me. She frightened the bejesus out of my ancestors. But I lived to fight another day. Here's music from Macy Gray then, while we figure out what to do next. Here's Macy Gray on the Richie Allen Radio Show on Monday. Yeah. What a tune, Macy Gray on the Richie Allen Show. I try. Yeah. I just had an email from Vernon. He said, Richie, I loved your story about having a bet with yourself and finding that all universities have taken Bill Gates' money. It reminded me, says Vernon, of an English cricket player in the 19th century on tour of Australia. He won a lot of money betting that he could predict the exact score made by every batsman. He got decent odds. He bet that each player would score zero. And some always did. They jailed him, I think, which was a pity because he was the wicket keeper. I wonder, will my Irish listeners understand? I'm sure they will. That's good stuff, that. Dr. Vernon Coleman. Do go to vernoncoleman.com, and if you can't print out those leaflets, copy and paste the text and off you go. 21 minutes to the top of the hour. David Vance was due to be with me, but David's daughter sadly has had a minor traffic accident. He's had to go and pick her up and look after her. And of course, in the ensuing chaos, forgot about the radio show today, but we'll get him back on. Patricia Braunschweiler, great friend of ours. Patricia, thanks for your support and your friendship since the beginning of this program. It means the world to me. It really does. Here's a question, Richie. There are so many doctors who claim that masks do nothing against COVID. The non-maskers are made out to be crazy. Apparently, in the US, they go into stores and create chaos. I'm starting to believe there is an agenda, she says with a question. Well, look, answers on a postcard. Do a tweet me. It's at Richie Allen Show. It's so strange. These times are so strange that I'm more inclined than ever before to consider anything to be possible. But there's a danger in that. And the danger in that is, and of course it doesn't mean that the point Patricia makes is right. I think Patricia might very well be right. There is an agenda. But the more suspicious you get of everything, the more difficult it is for you to settle on anything. Do you get where I'm coming from? And I've noticed this quite a bit during my own journey in the independent media. I've met many people over the years, lovely people, and they've tied themselves up in knots. Again, I'm not referring to Patricia here. Very smart woman, very good analytical thinker is Patricia. But I've met people over the years and they get to the stage where they just don't believe anything. You might think, what's wrong with that, Richie? But I suppose there are things that have happened. There are things even which are true. But yeah. Paul says, Richie, good evening. He says, the last thing you could be accused of is being boring. Thank you, Paul. Yes, I would just give up, really. An idiot at times, a bit of an idiot. Certainly wrong often, but never boring. I don't think I've ever done a dull show. No doubt about it. A lot of kind words for Vernon Coleman on Twitter today. That's very kind. Daz says, Richie, my dad had a Hillman Hunter when I was 9. I let the handbrake off and it rolled back into a tree, says Daz. The tree was written off. Yeah, it was a tank. It was a tank. And my mother, when driving, had a lead foot. She had ball bearings in her ankles. A very quick driver. Ridiculously quick. Faisal says, Richie, don't worry. I've got friends and family who are Muslim and they all think the burqa is ridiculous. It's not a Muslim thing. It's Wahhabism. Thank you, Faisal. You are very, very right. Not that you need me to tell you that. Of course, you know more about it than I do. Of course, Wahhabism and Hemfer. Oh, look, we could be here all day long. 20 minutes to the top of the air, but I won't bore you with all of that. The radical interpretation of Islam, it is believed by me, for one, was introduced by secret agents of the British Empire, was introduced to the Middle East, well, basically to ferment, divide and conquer. Now, the right-wingers don't like that, of course. They want to believe that, basically, that there is a streak running right through Islam that wants to take over. That they're taking over and supplanting Christianity with Islam is in the DNA of every Muslim. Now, this is patently bollocks. I know this. And I know I'm stirring some shit now. I know some of my listeners won't like me saying it. And you'll be, oh, I'm not listening to him anymore. But, yeah. Hemphill, was that his name? I did a show on it once, no doubt about it. But speaking of free speech, you know, I pop around to a laundrette around the corner. Why, is the future Mrs. Allen a lazy biatch? Is she? Does the future Mrs. Allen refuse to watch the BBG's smalls and panty, not pantyhose, underpants? No, she doesn't. She doesn't, but she's got enough going on. So what I do is I take my running gear and one or two things and I pop round the local laundrette. It's me doing my bit for the local economy. And there are some lovely women working in said laundrette. Lovely ladies. Lovely ladies. Very opinionated ladies. But then again, they would be in Salford. Lots to say. And that's a great thing. And one of them is Jane. And Jane is mixed race, but her skin is dark. You could say Jane is black. Lovely woman. Father is from the Caribbean. Mum, I believe, from Salford. And I know that Jane listens in every now and then when she has the time to do so. She works a couple of jobs. Old school. Works a couple of jobs. Works in a supermarket as well. And Jane chats with me about Black Lives Matter. She talks to me about that. And she doesn't have a lot of sympathy for Black Lives Matter, Jane. And I says, why? Because I like to be the devil's advocate, you see, in conversations. I like to take the opposing viewpoint, even if I don't share it, because it's good fun. And I'm like, I'm saying to Jane, I think there's a lot of good stuff in Black Lives Matter. And stop and search and racism, we can't say that it doesn't exist and what have you. And Jane says, look, and this is, I love this. She says to me, look, nobody is going to tell me that I'm a victim and that I need to be protected from hearing things. Now, you might think that she got that line directly out of my mouth. She didn't. She said it herself. Nobody's going to tell me that I need to be looked after. Mollycoddled. That I'm too sensitive to be confronted by people and by things that I don't like. What was interesting was, you might remember last week, it was all over the news. There is a dance group called Diversity, which is made up of black men, young black men, I think. I'm reliably told they are astonishing. Brilliant, apparently. Gravity-defying stuff from these lads. And they pulled off a routine on Britain's Got Talent, didn't they, a couple of weeks ago, and it ended with somebody kneeling on somebody's head. So it was a political statement. And people were up in arms. And 15,000 people complained to Ofcom, which regulates the media in this country. 15,000 dipsticks who ought to be doing better things than complaining about a dance routine. Jane was complaining about it. Jane was saying, it's a load of nonsense. Most of my black friends, she said, think it's nonsense. And I said, ha-ha. But you either believe in freedom of expression and free speech, or you don't, Jane. And she went, you're right. I suppose when you look at it that way. Well, it's true, isn't it? There's no buts or ifs about free speech or free expression. So you've got a problem with immigration. You've got a problem with being told that you are a racist. And, well, you might have a problem with being told that you are a racist because you are not a racist. I'm pretty sure you're not. I know I'm not. And I talked about this before. We are being gaslit constantly by the media. People are being gaslit. We are being told by the media constantly that we are worthless, that we are dirty, that we are bigoted, that we are racist. It's part of a gaslighting agenda. It's a real thing. To do what? Well, to demoralise us. To demoralise us on the one hand, and on the other hand, to keep us fighting with one another over things that don't make a blind bit of effing difference. Because what colour skin you are doesn't matter. Who you go to bed with doesn't matter. And whose God you kneel before doesn't matter either. So diversity might have been a bit immature and a bit foolish. And they might be misguided. And I think they probably are. But don't they have the right to do whatever dance routine they want? And shouldn't we then have the right to criticise it? But not to demand that they don't do it again or that they are censored. How about we have a debate about it? How about get the diversity lads into studio? Hey lads, great routine lads. Fucking hell. Gravity defying stuff lads. But what was all that at the end? We're not in a place anymore where we do that. Those days are gone now. Everybody wants the thing that they don't like to be removed from their viewpoint or from their field of hearing or from their depth of hearing, their field of hearing. Oh, get rid of him. Why? Do you hear what he said? Ah, so you want to get rid of him because of what he said? Yes. It's either free speech for everybody or for nobody. You know? And I'll get abuse. But look, I've said it 1,000 times. Nobody has done more on immigration as an agenda to divide and conquer and to impoverish than me. I've said it before. I've said it 1,000 times. No genuine trade unionist or genuine socialist back in the 70s or in the 80s, none of them thought that unfettered immigration was a good thing. Not because they were closeted bigots who didn't like anybody that sounded a bit different or looked a bit different. No, they didn't think it was a good thing because they knew that jobs were at a premium anyway. It's bad enough around here to try and get a job in Murphy's factory. Fucking hell, you're lucky if you have 20 vacancies a year there. So we don't need any more competition for those jobs, you know? That's what it was. Strange how the right and the left have kind of gone upside down on some of these issues. Brexit is another one. You had the left, Momentum, Jeremy Corbyn's supporters, legions of idiots, screaming about Brexit, screaming that we should never leave the European Union. And yet, Jeremy Corbyn himself, Tony Benn, Michael Foote, go all the way back, were all vehemently opposed to the UK's continuing membership of the European Union for some of the reasons I've given already. These are strange times for free speech. Most of the people I invite on this programme turn me down. Because, not in a bad way, it's not because they feel that they would be tainted by association with some of the people I've had on in the past. No, that does still happen. I will invite a politician on or an academic on and they will say, I can't come on, Richie, because you had some bloke on before and he was a Holocaust denier and I can't come on because I'll be hammered. Fair enough. It's a bit weak, but fair enough. No, usually they decline to come on because they just don't want an argument. Like I will say in the email, hey, listen, you believe this and believe that. I don't. Let's have an old ding-dong about it on the air. No. Why would I want to do that? Well, it's good fun for a start. I'm going to let you speak. We'll have a proper ding-dong for 45 minutes and at the end of it, we'll have a big cyber hug. You piss off, I'll piss off, and the audience can make their own minds up. Not about who won. Because it doesn't matter about winning. Nobody wins anything. But the audience might say, Jesus, that guy Richie had on. He put Richie in his place. Or he had some points that Richie couldn't answer. Or vice versa. This is where we are in 2020. Yeah. Yeah. Lot of comments coming in there. Thanks for tweeting me today. Let me tell you, Mark Windows joins me on Wednesday. And I'm thrilled that an old friend of the programme who's not been on for, well, for over 1.5 years. I'll be joined by Sarah Westall on Thursday. And I'm going to fit a phone in this week. And I think it might be tomorrow. Watch this space. Watch this space, as it were. Yeah, we'll do a phone-in because we're about
we're a good month since we did a phone-in, and I do want to have you on, and I want to hear you. So we'll do that. If you've joined the programme late, you did miss Dr. Vernon Coleman, the one and only. The show, of course, will be, as usual, uploaded to Podomatic, and from there it goes to iTunes, to Spotify, and I will put it on YouTube. But hear me. My patience has nearly run out with YouTube. Excuse me. What do you mean, Paulie? Are they deleting you? No. No, they're not. They're not. They're not deleting me. But there's nothing in it for me. Do you understand? Was it all about the money, Baldy? No, it isn't all about the money either. Never was, never will be. But there's nothing in it for me. They prevent more people from seeing it than actually they allow to see it. They're constantly fiddling with the numbers, with the number of subscribers and the numbers of viewers to any given episode of the radio show. It's just a pain in the arse. It's a live radio show. It's live now. I'm live now. And then it goes to the aforementioned platforms. So I say to the YouTube people, just stop being a lazy arse. Stop being a dipstick. Get the podcast from podomatic.com. It's free. It doesn't cost you a penny. And you don't have to download any invasive software. No, you don't. Just go to podomatic.com. Look for Richie Allen and press play. Mother of divine Jesus Christ, Joseph, Mary and all the saints. It's easy. Takes me a couple of hours to get it on YouTube, to create the video. There's only me, you see. Me. And a lovely email from a guy yesterday. And you know I never brag. You know I don't. Bragging is for idiots. We all know I'm a genius. There's no need to do it. To brag. I got an email from a guy, I could read it out, from a guy called Neil Ryan in Dublin. I won't read it out. He said, I listened to Sunday View yesterday. He said, I've never heard anything like it. How do you do that? I said, ha-ha. I do it, Neil, by getting up at 5:30 on Sunday morning, by listening to 4 different radio and television programmes myself, by then extracting audio clips, usually a dozen, to 14 from those television and radio programs. While doing that, I'm making bullet points about those interviews and I am reviewing the claims made in those interviews online while also reading the Sunday newspapers. If I was to be doing the Richie Allen radio show on a commercial radio station, there would be 4 people on the team. There's me. I'm having it today. That's how I get it done. It was the same today. You heard a news roundup, packed with audio and information. Takes hours to do it. Hours. It takes fucking hours. I've been at it since 6:00 this morning. So to now have to go and make a fucking YouTube video is the last thing in the world I want to do. What I want to do is have a cold beverage. Cuddle up to the oft-mentioned herself, the Minister for Home Affairs. But I do the YouTube thing and it takes time. So I will stop it really soon. I'm going to stop it. I won't delete the YouTube channel. I'll leave the videos there until they eventually delete it. But I'm getting tired of it because it's of no use to me. It doesn't affect the listening numbers of the radio programme, so I couldn't give an arse. Do you understand? That's where I am with that. So there you go. Alrighty. Marvellous. So we'll fit a phone in this week. And a number of you have been asking me about why I haven't had much to say about protests in London. There's a few things I'd like to say, but I'm going to keep my powder dry and I'm not going to say anything at all. How about them apples? I've got some opinions about some of the people involved in London on Saturday and the conduct of said people, but I'm not going to say anything because no good will come of it. And I still believe, and I'm not a hypocrite, my word is my bond. It's a good thing to take part in gatherings in London and in Sheffield and in Leeds. And the most important thing is that these doctors, Sherry Tenpenny and Mohammed Adil and Kaufman, all who've been on this programme, it's important that those doctors are heard and showcased. They should be the story. You with me? You hearing me? They should be the story. The focus of the attention should be on those learned men and women and what they have to say. But the attention always ends up somewhere else, doesn't it? And there I've broken my own promise not to weigh in. But that's as far as I'll go. I'll have nothing more to say about that. Truther, industrial complex. You've got to tear it down before you'll make any progress in taking on the tyranny that we're reporting on today on Monday's Richie Allen Radio Show. So I've got to go then. I've waffled on long enough, as I have, and I'm going to put it on YouTube this week, maybe next week, and then I'm going to start putting it on YouTube. Let's see, what have we got lined up? Have I got anything lined up? Have I? I have. I've got a tune lined up to go out with. Thanks again to Dr. Vernon Coleman. Go to vernoncoleman.com. Go to Brand New Tube. Look for Vernon Coleman. David Vance will reschedule David on the programme next week or this week or whenever. We'll get David back on the Richie Allen Radio Show. Lovely to be with you today, and I look forward to speaking to you tomorrow at 5. Until then, you take care of yourselves. Enjoy the lovely weather. It's lovely and balmy this Monday, Indian summer, and another lovely day promised for us tomorrow on Tuesday as well. I'm off for a cold beverage. Oh yeah. I'll see you tomorrow. Until then, do the hustle. Bye for me.